Like, no,
yeah.
No, nobody.
And you know what?
Shit.
It's a great point, because I remember auditioning for a 1-800 call ATT set of commercials, and I was nailing these. And it was one of these things where I had like two callbacks, and every time people in stitches, right? And then I'm calling my manager at the time. I'm like, what? Am I getting that or what? And I found out it went to David Arquette, who was huge at the time from Scream. And when he did the commercials, he made it like annoying. They were like embarrassingly annoying, not funny whatsoever. So I look and I go, I would have nailed that and made it funny, but they chose the star name. And then eventually Carrot Top took over. So, you know, I don't know where that went. But you can't, it's always a tough situation where they obviously cast David Arquette because they were, you know, in search of the money. But, you know, it happens all the time. The fact that they'll put, Robert De Niro, the most Italian guy ever, as the lead in The Irishman, you know what I mean? Versus like Brendan Gleeson, who looked like the actual guy and, you know, is just as good an actor, in my opinion. But De Niro is the name De Niro. So it happens on the big levels. I mean, what's his name? Liam Neeson auditioned for Dead Poets Society, and he was probably better than Robin Williams, but they had Robin Williams.
Yeah. I auditioned for, I think it was, I don't know if it was Four Christmases or what the heck it was. It was, I think John Favreau directed it. And, I can't think of his name now off the top of my head. He's a huge actor, 6'4", who was in like tons of comedies. What's his name, Vinny? Vince Vaughn. Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Cheech. Vince Vaughn is in it. So I auditioned, and it was, like you said, it was MMA guy. So like all these like 75-year-old agents were like, oh, you do MMA also, so you're going to be auditioning for MMA guy. Well, let me tell you right now, like the average cast director does not think that like Jason Chambers looks like MMA guy. They want tattooed, you know, bald guys, the piercings. They had the, especially back in like 2006, 2007, 2008, there was a completely different perception of it. And, you know, obviously I didn't book the role, and I'm like, I wonder who the hell booked that role. You know who ended up booking the MMA fighter role? John Favreau. I'm like, you directed it. He put himself in that role as like MMA fighter. Like, talk about total opposite ends of the spectrum. Like, there's never a scenario in my life where I and John Favreau are auditioning for the same character. I mean, he's directing it, so I'm sure he just was like, nah, I'm going to be this guy. But
you know what? But it does come around. Like, I mentioned Liam Neeson, Dead Poets Society. That's because Liam Neeson was nobody back then. Now, if Robin Williams was still alive and they were both going for it, Liam Neeson's bigger. I mean, like, as far as a dramatic actor, he's bigger. But, you know, it's Bruce Lee losing Kung Fu about a Chinese person that does Kung Fu to an American David Carradine, but ultimately, who's a bigger name? You know, who's remembered? Probably the one of only two monster Asian stars, Jackie Chan being the other one. You know, and obviously there's a couple more, but where you could just say their name and you know who they are. Bruce Lee, ultimately. So to give a shred of hope is that if you just ultimately keep trying, and you know the right role may come around for you, where you know John Favreau is not even a thought compared to you, but it's Jamie Foxx. When he did Ray, he was on Sunday Morning Shootout, which was an old producer show that was great. He said that they wanted who are they saying? They wanted Don Cheadle, or they wanted somebody else, a couple different guys that were bigger. And then now, who's bigger now? You know, Jamie Foxx at that point went on, won the Oscar. So then ultimately it always turns around if you keep at it, you know.
Yeah, you just gotta hustle. I mean, I remember when I was in a meeting at Abrams Artist. I won't mention the guy's name, but mainly because I don't remember it. And I was in a meeting with their commercial department, and Hulu was like really the one of the first online platforms for movies. And it was, you know, the shift was just beginning to start. People were watching Hulu. And I remember asking them, so how do you think this is going to impact, you know, like the television industry with these online platforms? And I remember him just laughing, go, Hulu's not going to be around in 2 years. He's like, they don't know how to monetize that. He was so dismissive. And I was like, really? Because like technology and like things like that are ever evolving, and people are always finding better and more efficient ways to do that. And you look at even like using the internet, the average person was using a laptop. Now 95% of the people are accessing the internet on their cell phone, right? So like it's crazy to me to see how things change and how much more efficient. I mean, my buddy Chris Headshots, for instance, he's like, you've gotten headshots done, right? And it's, you go there and it's a 3-hour process and you're there forever. You got to put on all this crap and shit, and it's a big process. I came in with my buddy Chris. He's got this awesome setup. He can get in and out in like 15 minutes and get like 150 looks. And he's got Gary V these shot and a bunch of people, and it's just so much more efficient when you do those things.
You know, it being in the Bitcoin world, you know that it's like that famous article that was like, the internet will never replace fax machines, or, you know, whatever it was. It was like, oh, or some, or the email will never replace fax machines, something ridiculous like that. But there's always, and how many people have said Bitcoin are never, you know, it's a fad, it's dropping the pan as they're watching it climb and climb. So yeah, if you're resistant to that, it's a big mistake. And I just think that's great that the guy told you Hulu was going to be around in 2 years. And it's like,
he's probably working at, yeah, he's probably working at Starbucks with your old.
Yeah. Everybody apparently ends up there.
They all just shuffle to the Starbucks on Hollywood Boulevard at some point. You know? It's, so what would be, if someone's listening to this and they're like, man, I'm an aspiring actor and I really want to get into this. What's your guidance for them?
Well, I would say that especially today, you have to create your own content and do something that's unique and funny and continually do it. You know, that's the key, is that if you don't, if you think that it's, oh, I'm going to make one good video and then see where that goes, that's the mistake that you don't, that doesn't exist as much anymore. Obviously, there's lottery tickets. Somebody made one video and it went nuts and, you know, all that stuff. And you always hear those stories because they always publicize the lottery tickets. But using a lottery ticket as your business plan is never a smart move. Like, you know, saying, I'm going to get rich one day. How? I'm just going to keep playing the lottery. Like, most likely you'll die and you'll never win the lottery. So I would say create content and put it out there and regularly do that. But at the same time, concurrently be looking for any opportunity to be in anything, to be in films. You know, I've almost never turned down a role. If people ask me, hey, would you like to be in this? Now, obviously, a little bit more discerning, almost more for money's sake than, and time than the desire to be in everything. But early on as an actor, be in anything, anything that somebody will put you in, do it and do it well and put your A game, bring your A game. Don't phone it in. You know, so many people are just trying for that Kardashian celebrity status and not looking at it as, I want to be amazing at this. You know, that's a great Michael Caine thing. He says, you know, he doesn't recommend just going to try to be a celebrity. He says, but being known as a great actor is a hell of a trip, you know? So look at and say, I want to be the, you know, I want to be one of the best as an actor and bring my A game to everything. Sooner or later, I think you're going to be discovered.
So talking about being discovered, I remember when I first moved to Los Angeles and like, you know, it's very, you know, it's easy to get starstruck, right? Because we're always like, we look up to the people that we want to, you know, emulate their careers. And I was in Target. And, you know, this is like literally the first week I was there and I'm just buying some bullshit. And behind me was Adrian Brody, who had just come off of winning the Academy Award for The Pianist. And he's buying toilet paper. And I'm like, oh, he shits too. That's so cool. And it was just a very surreal moment. Like, I mean, I tell the story. I went to your house, I think it was for a birthday party or something. And Jack Black was over there just leaving and stuff. What's your biggest geek out moment? Do you have any fanboy moments being able to be in this entertainment
That's
industry?
That's a good one. Well, mine is very interesting because it's funny enough, and I'm, you know, I don't want to say this for any other reason that, you know, because it's great. I do obviously geek out on anybody that I'm working with, but I've never looked at any actor and put them in anywhere above me at all. In fact, most of the time when I see famous actors, I'm like, I'm better than that guy. Like literally that's in my head every single time. I'm like, I'm so much better than them. You know, and so that's always been in my head that I can put my A game up against anybody and bring it and be better. Right. But the geek out moment for me was meeting the producer, Robert Evans, who was, you know, to me, the greatest producer of all time. Godfather 1 and 2, Chinatown, Love Story, and took Paramount from number 9 of 9 to number 1 of 9 in his time there. And to me, it was just so cool to meet this guy that had put these projects together and made a studio. And I mean, that was power, right? And so I would say meeting Robert Evans, and he talked like a 1940s detective. And I said, we had watched it. We had been to a screening of a movie called Middlemen, which was Luke Wilson and Giovanni Ribisi. And I sat right next to him the whole screening. And then afterwards I said, Bob, that was a good film, right? He goes, good film? No, it's a great film. You know, and he said, and I said to him afterwards, we were taking a picture. I said, why don't we make a movie together? And he goes, fucking A, yeah. You know, and he had this great. And so that is my biggest geek out moment is being able to get the, to meet the, like I said, the greatest producer maybe of all time, somebody that came from nothing. And those are the people that I love that come from nothing and build this empire.
Yeah, it's crazy. You know, when people would come visit me in Los Angeles, the first thing they'd ask is like, oh, where can we go to see celebrities? And I'm like, Target, Walmart, like that's like, yeah. They're not just like hanging out in front of their house on the tour bus. Like, hey, you're going by Tom Cruise's house. He's just watering his grass. Hey, that's like,
but you know, what's cool is that is a thing. You know, I remember talking to some people that were in especially in small towns that don't ever, that think that it's too much to be able to get those people as a peer group and friends. And I never had that feeling in my life, but they, a lot of them do. I remember talking to, gosh, my mother-in-law when we were living in the hills in Sherman Oaks. And I said, you know, something about Beverly Hills. And she goes, is that like all roped off? And I go, what? You know, she came from a small town. I go, what do you mean roped off? She said, like, well, can you go in there? I go, yes. I go, my kid's library is there. That's where we're going to, you know. And so it, I think for a lot of people, they think that this is some kind of unattainable goal, or that these people are just real people trying. You know, it was amazing to me how I would do a movie and have celebrities that I knew my whole life, maybe watched them on TV or seen them in movies. And then afterwards they would turn around and they'd be like, well, what do you, you know, you got another role for me? And it was like, whoa, geez, that's amazing to feel that and know that they're all trying to, no matter what, they're trying to get their projects going. And they're, you know, I've obviously at the top, you know, maybe Jack Black, again, who's a friend, maybe he's not as worried about it, but he definitely definitely put a ton of effort in early on. And that's another thing I'll go back to, what an actor should do, that I know I made this mistake, is don't play every type of role. I played dramatic roles. I played in horror movies. I played, and it, I always knew comedy was my strongest suit. And only now am I saying I'm only doing comedies. As a director, I'm only going to do comedies. As an actor, I'm only going to do comedy. And that should have been from day one. I should have tried to turn down everything. So meaning, if you're an actor and you're going, I want to do horror movies, only do horror movies. Don't do dramatic stuff. Don't do comedy. Only do that. And you'll brand yourself. Because if I say Jack Black, you know, oh, I got a role for him because you know his type, right? But he didn't play all over the board. And very few actors that have done that. I can think of Gary Oldman, Daniel Day-Lewis, that maybe have done all types. They're not A-list stars. They are, but they're not monster names because they did not have one type. And it took them a while to get there.
Yeah, even like the Jack Blacks and the Kevin Harts of the world and stuff during the pandemic. I mean, those guys are huge names. Everyone knows those guys. But they both still are on YouTube, TikTok, Instagram. They're creating content. They're still going out there and they're still pushing their content forward. It's so important. You got to have that hustle and drive. There's so many people that like they're flooring it in neutral. You know, they're driven, but they're not going anywhere.
One of my favorite things as an actor is I used to tell this story when I'd say, like, who makes more money on the top level, a doctor or an actor? And obviously it's an actor. And one day an actor can make more than a doctor, maybe their whole career can make, right? So, but I would say, but how long do you think it takes to be a doctor? And they would say, you know, well, you got to go through college and you got to get that, you could have residence and all together about 10 to 12 years to be a working doctor, 10 to 12 years. But then you have heard it and I've heard it. I've heard actors be like, yeah, I gave the acting thing a try for like 5 months. It's like, but you gave the acting thing a try for 5 months. Like, that's not a commitment. Like, to me, every year I'm thinking, all right, this is my year. I'll be 80 years old. They'll be wheeling me into an audition. I'm like, this is the one, this is the year. You know, so to me, it was always like, never stop or never give up and look at it as enjoy the journey. That took me a while, too, before I said enjoy the journey. It's easier when you're making money doing it. But the bottom line is you have to be in it 100%. You got to be in that pool instead of dipping your toes in the water.